a piece called Cambridge 1969.
Hello there, and welcome to Weird Music on the Glumberger Channel, the show where we dive into, you know, the world of music and albums out there, just, you know, talk about different kinds of things, right? today, I think this is going to be a bit of a frustrating episode for a couple of you out there. This is an album that is chaotic, discordant, avant-garde, improvised, and just baffling in every respect of the word. Now for me, I genuinely find albums like this very interesting, but I'm not sure if I enjoy them, who knows. More on that later though. But yeah, this album, it certainly confounded and angered many people upon its release, you know, despite its predecessor being, you know, a controversial mess of an album that also angered many people. So today, I present to you the strange collaborative album from 1969. Unfinished Music No. 2, Life with the Lions, by John Lennon and Yoko Ono. Alrighty then, let's ask ourselves, who is John Lennon and Yoko Ono? I genuinely feel like it's moot to ask ourselves this, but whatever, let's speedrun a summary, shall we? John Lennon is an English singer-songwriter famous for starting the band The Beatles, alongside members Paul McCartney, George Harrison and Ringo Starr. Yoko Ono was Lennon's second wife, a Japanese avant-garde performer who was part of the Fluxus movement in the 1960s. Somewhat controversial performer whose style of music really confuses and baffles people. And of course, made her ripe for parodying in the world of media, right? That's as far as I'll go into it. I think it's a better question to be asking ourselves is, what is Unfinished Music No. 2, Life with the Lions? Well, this is an experimental collaborative album from both Lennon and Ono, comprising of some of the most confusing and baffling recordings ever released, I would argue. The Unfinished Music series, though, was an attempt by both Ono and Lennon to make a record of their life together. In fact, they made 3 albums under this project, with the sound itself being conceptualized as not being printed into the vinyl's grooves, but rather into the listener's mind. Very unusual, right? And these albums comprise such disparate sources of ideas and sound, arguably being avant-garde for the sake of being avant-garde, I don't know. It's such a contentious point that perhaps I shouldn't even go there, but this is an album, it was released, and therefore it is perfect for discussion on weird music, so let's just dive into it then, shall we? So, Unfinished Music No. 2. It opens up with the incredibly challenging track Cambridge 1969, a colossal 26-minute track sourced from what was apparently the second live performance from both Lennon and Ono. What is this track, though? This is 26 minutes of distorted guitar feedback, accompanied by the customary vocal performances from Yoko Ono. And there you have it. That is it. You have side one of this baffling record, track one, side eight, the album opener. It's one of the most ridiculous, most craziest things I've ever heard, and it's so absurd for so many different reasons. There is something so absurdly strange about this track, but I also find it kind of funny and weird as well. Like, the more this track goes on and on, the more funny I find the piece. It's just constant guitar feedback, screeching, whining, distorting, collapsing and building in the most ridiculous fashion, no form or structure to it whatsoever. It should be said though, as the track reaches its ending, we do get the addition of some more musical layers to help make this track feel a little bit more interesting, though I feel like it's come way too late in this song. So saxophonist John Chachi, I don't know how to say it, sorry, and percussionist John Stevens both join the live performance towards the end, who both just add to the confusing miasma of sound and noises. It becomes almost like this freeform, free jazz type recording, except apart from being that, it's completely dominated by the constant screaming and vocalizations of Yoko Ono, who is just doing her own thing entirely, regardless of what everybody else is doing, which I think is amazing and fantastic, even though it's so weird and mostly unlistenable. It's so weird. For me, it's kind of like Metal Machine music by Lou Reed, offset by the deranged screaming of Yoko Ono. And as well, the more the track goes on, the more, this is really weird, but the more it goes on, the more I kind of find myself appreciating the performance of Yoko Ono. Bear with me on this. It is completely unhinged in every respect, completely nonsensical and absurd, but she keeps up the performance for the entire 26 minutes, just this constant vocalization. And how does one do that, you know? It's like she keeps finding new ways to present her voice in such horrible, unlikable forms and ways, and maybe that's the performance she's trying to do here. Is this like an original form of anti-music, maybe? I should say, as well, just quickly, it's really weirdly funny at the very end when she does this weirdly elongated passage of squawking and screaming that sounds like an angry bird trying to wake you up in the morning, before the musical side of it, which is so difficult to pay attention to due to the dominating factor being that is Ono, it just all falls apart in this chaotic mess, and it leaves just the saxophone to pick up the wreck of pieces that they've left behind. And my goodness, it's such a baffling track, but there's something weird about it, something weirdly brilliant and unique about it. So, just to keep going on around, it's such a monolithic and crazy recording that it's just incomprehensible and literally very difficult to listen to. And I will say here, I love a long composition, of course, and I do enjoy the avant-garde, the confusing records of the world. But I would say even this might be a little bit too much for me. Like, this thing fries my brain in such an uncomfortable way that I can't even begin to comprehend the onslaught of noise that is being pushed out in the headphones. And yes, it's weirdly funny in places, but it's also just ridiculous and, you know, strange and I don't even know. Like, so, like, let's consider this. Let's consider the idea that this is one of the first shows of an ex-Beatles member post-breakup, right? Imagine, pun intended, that you're a massive fan of the Beatles, and you see a poster that is showing that Lennon's going to be performing live music again, with his new wife, of course. Amazing, right? However, this scenario requires that you forget that the White Album exists, by the way. So just imagine. So you see your favourite performer's going to perform again, like solo stuff. Wow, this is going to be amazing. So you pop along to this live show. And like, there he is on the stage with his guitar, and his wife Yoko's there, he's got a microphone, there's even a saxophonist and a drummer. So, oh wow, this is going to be very interesting, this is going to be cool, what little bop rock songs are they going to play? But no, you just get greeted with the most atonal and uncomfortable noise ever concocted in the late 60s. Like, I can imagine, this must have pissed off so many people. But I find that really funny for some reason. Like, to be fair also, maybe the joke is also on me, because I have listened to this track a lot of times in preparation for this video, but you know, that is also quite funny, isn't it? And so, I will say here, literally Cambridge 1969 was one of the main reasons why I wanted to cover this album on Weird Music, because when I first heard this many years ago, I was just completely like, whoa, what is going on here? But also, there is something weird and wonderful about the just absurd anti-music nature of it all, if that makes sense. Like, the fact it's so unlikable makes it interesting, but of course it's still unlikable at the end of the day, and that is... it's weird. It's so weird. Let's talk about the rest of the album, though. So on side B, we get a bunch of tracks, that actually explore the sort of concept of, presenting their life through, you know, these musical snapshots, essentially. And so side B opens up with the 4-minute No Bed for Beetle John. And this is a very interesting track in terms of its concept. What you have is clips of Yoko Ono, you know, singing and reading press clippings regarding herself and John Lennon, whilst Lennon is doing the very same thing in the background of the recording. And in particular, Ono vocalises a clip regarding her hospitalisation and miscarriage before she vocalises one regarding the controversy regarding Lennon and Ono's first collaborative album, Unfinished Music No. 1, Two Virgins, which was very controversial due to its album art depicting both artists in the nude. I will say here as well, Yoko Ono has this very weird fascination with, I think, presenting John Lennon in the nude. If you had a look at Cactus Malpractice's video for Yoko Ono's Fly, he mentions in it the whole film that Yoko Ono made, which is just John Lennon's genitals, basically. Which is so weird. But of course, with it being on an album art, this was incredibly controversial. They got into a lot of trouble for it. That controversy made itself into this song through the press clip and through the reading of it, which is interesting, I think. I find it to be an interesting track as a result. It provides this very peculiar sonic snapshot of the press, who no doubt hounded both artists, you know, covering every facet of their lives in this really unusual, almost pervasive detail, I would say. And conceptually, the whole Unfinished Music series, you know, it was attempts by Ono and Lennon to create a record of their life together. And with tracks like No Bed for John, Beetle John, we get an insight into their lives and what was happening to them, you know, and I think it's really fascinating as a result. Like, it's a weird track to listen to. It's not really music per se, but it is interesting. Anyway, the album moves on to the next track of Baby's Heartbeat, which is another very interesting avant-garde recording, but it has this incredibly tragic backstory to it. And so we mentioned it in the previous track, the hospitalization of Ono due to her miscarriage. And so Baby's Heartbeat, it sees the two creating a recording of that very Baby's Heartbeat, which was posthumously named John Ono Lennon II. And what they do is they have the sound source of it, and they loop it to create this very peculiar soundscape indeed. And what you get is just the incessant beating of the baby's heart buried deep within the womb of Ono. And for me, I find there to be something very interesting about it. It's incredibly morbid, but there's something bittersweet and beautiful about it, you know? Very sad, though, as well, but in a weird way, like, it's, you know, a way of expressing the life of someone who didn't live, if that makes sense. It's very unusual. To go into a bit more, though, apparently Ono has referenced infant mortality in a bunch of her works, including in her book Grapefruit, and in the song Greenfield Morning, I Push an Empty Baby Carriage All Over the City from her album Yoko Ono Classic Ono Band. And here we see, you know, a very avant-garde pushing of these very concepts and ideas found within her fascination of infant mortality. And on this album, it creates a really uncomfortable, morbid experience of the heartbeat of a child who never got to live. But in a very weird way, it's like they've been immortalised to the very recording itself. And in terms of the whole concept of the album, though, as morbid as it is, as weird as it is, it still is an expression of their very life together and something very tragic that happened to them. And I think it's very interesting, and it gives this very unusual, unlikable album a lot of weight to it, to be fair, just purely for the inclusion of this one little moment. Moving on, though, we get the aptly named 2 Minute Silence, which is, surprisingly, 2 minute track comprising of only silence. Now, fair play to Lennon and Yoko, because an artist respects the silence as it serves as the foundation of creativity. But aside from that, there's really not much to say here, of course, is there? The track itself is in reference to the legendary John Cage, of course, but beyond that, what we have is simply a silent gap in the middle of the album experience. And so what does this do for us then? It does give us a pause and a respite in the middle of a cacophonous and uncomfortable listening experience. It gives us as listeners a chance to sort of breathe a bit and maybe contemplate the weird music we've been listening to for the past 30 minutes or so. And I find it interesting, though, as when we consider the avant-garde and music that goes against the grain itself, what could be more anti-music, essentially, than having a track that is the exact opposite of sound? A complete lack of sound entirely. And I think there's something to consider as well. Lennon's background in the Beatles, literally making some of the most popular music in the world, and then, you know, eschewing it entirely and diving completely into experimentalism and avant-garde. That is so weird and unusual, right? But kind of fascinating. Like, just going completely against all the forms and conventions and just going pure into pure expression of, well, whateverness, right? Anyway, we do move on to the track's final track of Radio Play. This is 12 and a half minutes of stuff happening to close off the whole album experience. To be fair, though, the CD version of Unfinished Music 2, it does have a couple of bonus tracks, but I don't feel like getting into it today. I just want to talk about the original album as it was originally released. And so, what is Radio Play? Well, basically put, is an experimental track featuring the sounds of a radio, whilst you have Lennon and Ono conversing at the background, and as well as Lennon making a phone call. And the whole thing just progresses with these weird bursts of staticky sound that stutter along at this uncomfortable pace. And that is all I can really say about it, to be fair. Like, it's very unusual. And I found this track really confused me to the point where I just really couldn't do much of anything. I kind of had to just, like, when I was listening to this to write about it, I kind of just had to wait for this one to end before I could articulate my thoughts on it, which seems to be a bit of a norm for most of these avant-garde albums. It's confusion leading to a lack of words, which means how do you begin to comprehend this stuff? But, like, it's very interesting, though, you know, that this is how the whole album ends, you know? You've got this complete, like, you know, the bombardment of baffling sounds and stuff that it makes for an experience that's very difficult to comprehend. But it still ties into so much of the themes and ideas that this whole album presenting. A snapshot of the life of John Lennon and Yoko Ono and all of its weirdness, but also its stark naturalness, if that makes sense. I think it's very weird. Like, it's such avant-garde music, but there's something very interesting about the idea of using abstract sound to express reality itself, if that makes sense. So essentially with that, we have covered Unfinished Music number 2, Vive with the Lions by John Lennon and Yoko Ono. So without a doubt, this is one of the weirdest and wonkiest albums I've ever come across, you know. It's weirdly enough as well, though, there are actually some elements I like about this. Like, I do get the controversy and the backlash that this album had upon release, you know, especially considering just how popular and accessible the music Lennon created was like. Imagine the surprise to anyone really, who popped into their music store and found a new record with John Lennon, of course. Bought it based on the single fact that it had John Lennon in, therefore it must be good. And then the first thing you're greeted with is the 26-minute behemoth of Cambridge 1969. I think there's something hysterical in a sort of schadenfreude kind of way. And perhaps that's a meta element of, you know, basically tricking the audience and listeners in maybe arguably a spiteful way. Maybe that's the point of it. It's also weird and confusing, though, but, you know, 1969 was a very unusual and weird year to release an album that sounds like this, I would argue, you know? Now, I would dare say it was kind of ahead of its time, you know, or anything, but maybe to an extent anyway, you know? I feel like a lot of the sort of weird stuff I've been listening to was definitely influenced by the kind of things that Yoko Ono was exploring, that Lennon was exploring, and just pure abstract sounds to express complex ideas. You know, it's very unusual. And so, before we close off, a couple more points I want to mention. I've had to go back and add this in because I'm an idiot who forgot to talk about these points. But anyway, I think it's worth discussing a little bit more about this album, the concept and the artwork and whatnot, essentially. So, the title, Life with the Lions, apparently a parody of the BBC radio comedy Life with the Lions. Though I think there's perhaps a bit more of a cynical and angry tone to this particular album's title. So, apparently, Life with the Lions, a reference to the press, who would constantly hound Lennon and Ono everywhere in their life. And this is perhaps referenced in songs like No Bed for Beetle John, where you just get these constant snippets of journalism discussing the lives of these two people who probably just wanted to get on with things, you know? And so Life with the Lions, you know, is sort of like living amongst, you know, very predatory behaviour almost. I mean, it's journalism, of course, but the paparazzi and stuff could be really horrible sometimes. And I think it's very, very interesting that it's expressed itself. To further go into it, though, I find it very interesting as well, the album's cover and back cover, which tell us an incredible amount of backstory to this particular album, as well as kind of showing some vulnerable sides to the two artists. So the cover art shows Ono lying upon a hospital bed with Lennon by her side, apparently taken at room number 1, 2nd West Ward, Queen Charlotte's Maternity Hospital, London, whilst Ono was suffering a miscarriage. And then the back photo features Lennon and Ono leaving Marylebone Police Station on October 19, 1968, after their arrest for the possession of hashish, apparently. And apparently the severe stress of publicity, the trauma of the very arrest, is what led to this miscarriage itself, apparently. And as such, the two, you know, in a way to sort of deal with, you know, your grief and stuff, felt a need to express the very experience through this performance of incredibly abstract music. And it's fascinating, you know. It's incredibly sad, I feel, how, you know, the behaviour of some people leads to horrible things happening without them realising, just hounding away led to this tragic miscarriage and stuff, and, you know, expressed through, you know, the baby's heartbeat and stuff, you know, in one of the very tracks and stuff. And so, you know, all of this turmoil, this experience, this nastiness, essentially, it makes up, you know, the core crux of so many of the tracks, especially on the second half. And it makes so much more sense when we consider what was happening within their very lives, you know? It's an abstract album, driven by grief and turmoil, confusion, and as a way to try process the invasive nature of journalists just constantly hounding you when all you're trying to do is just live your life and be yourselves, essentially. And to take so much of those experiences that are incredibly, you know, just full of turmoil again, you know, just very existential and unusual, and express it through the form of abstract art, I think it's incredibly interesting. And I think, you know, regardless of how you feel about the album, it feels like it's come from this weird place of sincerity, which I think is really odd for the most part. Because I find a lot of kind of stuff Lennon does every now and then to be very insincere. That's just my opinion, though. But it's interesting that, you know, there's this very stark nakedness to them, just expressing this, you know, tumultuous experience, essentially. And I think it's a fascinating album as a result, essentially. But yeah, with that, I think we're going to come to the end of our episode of Weird Music there. Strange album released by one of the most, you know, music's most prolific artists in partnership with one of music's most controversial artists, right? And I do get the hate and anger towards this stuff, but I don't love this album by any means. But I do find it very interesting, and the fact I find it interesting is why I wanted to talk about it on the show, essentially. it's interesting enough to talk about, for better or for worse, right? Like, Side A is just a behemoth of avant-garde music, right? Whatever. But Side B is this oddly touching story of self-reflection, of capturing rather melancholy moments in both artists' lives, and just sort of just the reality that was happening to them. And I find that interesting, to be fair. And so, I'll say here, when deciding to write up about this album, actually, I only remembered the first track from when I listened to it many, many years ago, so I was prepared for nonsense there, but I had completely forgotten about the album's second half, which in this instance of listening and absorbing it became this very unusual emotional experience in places. So credit due where credit is due. I appreciate a lot of the ideas being attempted here in this weird sort of sonic snapshot of very turbulent times. I think it's truly fascinating. Of course, it is a very weird, unlistenable album. And so with that, I would like to thank you for watching today's episode of Weird Music. I wish you all the best, take care, and bye-bye for now. Bye-bye!